Hi, this is Remembering the Past, the show where we talk about people who've died recently who've had a profound effect on our history, our society, or our culture. A couple of weeks back, we did Vincent Scully, who was one of the legendary teachers at Yale University. And tonight, we're going to do another legendary teacher from Yale University, Carm Cozza, who died recently at the age of 87. But he wasn't your traditional teacher. He was a football coach, and he was a legendary football coach at Yale. He coached there for 32 years between the 1960s and 1990s and won 179 games, which is 100 more than any other Yale football coach. He won 15 Ivy League championships, and 9 of those titles came between 1967 and 1981, a 14-year span which produced some of the best contemporary players in Yale history, including Calvin Hill, Brian Dowling, Dick Geron, Gary Fensick, John Spagnuolo, and Rich Diana. Maybe his best team at Yale was the 1968 team with Calvin Hill and Brian Dowling. It was the victim of 2 Harvard touchdowns and 2 Harvard two-point conversions in the last minute of the 1968 Harvard-Yale game. In fact, one of the reasons Harvard was able to tie that game was Yale was so good they didn't have an onside kick team because they had never needed it during the season. And in fact, people never stopped asking Carm Cozza about that game. Here he just mentions it.
It's that year before when we had that tie that seems to haunt me every year, especially Harvard week. There's at least 1, 2, maybe 3 or 4 different people call me on that game.
We'll dwell no longer on that. Carm Cozza was a nice Italian boy from Parma, Ohio. He went to Miami of Ohio University, where he played under Woody Hayes at Air Parsegian. Air Parsegian was key in his career. We've done the Air Parsegian podcast. His teammates included Bo Schembechler and Johnny Pont. And when Johnny Pont went to Yale to coach, he brought Carm Cozza with him. A couple years later, Johnny Pont camped for the Big Ten. And that's when Carm Cozza took over at Yale. As I said, he was not just a great football coach, but a great teacher. Of his approximately 1,500 players, only 7 failed to graduate. One of his players, John Paliero, said, "To play for Carm and his assistant coaches was like playing for family. He knew how to delegate to his assistant coaches, he knew how to be a leader, and he knew how to be a father, a brother, and a coach all at the same time. Not many coaches can do that and be effective and win championships." Another player, Dick Geron, who became an all-star in the NFL and also head coach, said, "Carm was a terrific man, a remarkable man. He obviously loved the game of football, but for the right reasons. The team part of it, the human part of it, the relationships part of it, the effort part of it, the determination. All the good things about the game." You don't hear that much anymore, by the way. A couple of anecdotes about Carm Cozza from his players. Here is the Yale legend Brian Dowling, immortalized as BD in the comic strip Doonesbury, who never played in a losing game from 7th grade throughout college, talking about Carm Cozza. And the word I got was Brian Dowling only had the 3rd best arm on the Yale football team after Calvin Hill, who played quarterback in high school, and Carm Cozza, who was a pitcher in the minor leagues.
You played for a legend in Carm Cozza, and everybody talks about Carm Cozza when they think of Yale sport, Yale football, Yale sports for that matter. Tell us about Carm, playing for Carm, and what it was like, maybe an anecdote that typifies his experience.
Well, it's really different because I came in as a freshman in his first year. So he was 34, 35 years old, very young. But one episode really stands out. We're sort of at the end of 2 days, and we still had 2 days. It's really hot, and people are on edge, and we usually sprint at the end of practice. He usually jumps out to the 40-yard line. Everybody's in the end zone, and they run in groups. No Carm. So everybody's looking around, where is he? And all of a sudden, a Good Humor truck drives onto the field, and he's at the wheel, and, you know, everybody had ice cream. So it was something you probably didn't find in the Big Ten.
Carm Cozza could have coached in the Big Ten or somewhere else. His predecessor Johnny Pont did. His contemporary Bob Blackman did. But he was content to stay at Yale. He saw hundreds of his players become successful professionals, lawyers, and doctors. As my friend Jim Munson, who played on the offensive line for him in 1967, said, "He was one of the most thoughtful, considerate guys he ever saw. He would do anything for his former players and went out of his way to remember them and help them out. But at the same time, he was a steely-eyed competitor, and he didn't like to lose." It's safe to say that Carm Cozza's name will be remembered at Yale for generations. Well, we're going to move on now to John Young, who died recently at the age of 87. He was an astronaut for 42 years, the only man who flew on a Gemini mission, an Apollo mission, and on the space shuttle. He took off from Earth for space 6 times, and he was in space for 835 hours total. He first flew on Gemini 3, the first two-man space mission with Gus Grissom. When Gus Grissom died a couple of years later in that launch pad fire, John Young became the leading advocate for astronaut safety. Gus Grissom had failed to complain about the wiring he knew was dangerous because he didn't want to get demoted. So John Young took up the role of ombudsman, which is ironic considering what ultimately happened to him. John Young also flew in Apollo 10, the lead up to the Apollo 11 moon landing. And in 1972, he was the commander of Apollo 16, and he was one of only 12 astronauts to set foot on the moon. He was the ninth. He and another astronaut, Charles Duke, drove a vehicle 16 miles across the lunar surface and collected more than 200 pounds of soil samples. Because of his emphasis on safety, the other astronauts looked up to him as a sort of a hero. And when we were no longer going to the moon, many of the astronauts went to the private sector, but he stayed with NASA. And in 1981, he was named the commander of the Columbia, the first space shuttle mission. He commanded the Columbia space shuttle 6 times, the last time in 1983. And as the spacecraft re-entered the Earth's atmosphere, 2 of its 3 auxiliary power units caught fire, and the ship was basically on fire when it re-entered Earth's atmosphere. In 1986, when the Challenger exploded, he witnessed it from the air while aboard a training aircraft. And in a scathing 12-page memo, he wrote that NASA management had compromised the astronaut's safety to move forward with the launch. What he said was there was only one driving reason that such a potentially dangerous system would ever be allowed to fly: launch schedule pressure, which is basically correct. Within a year, he was relieved of his duties as chief of the astronaut corps and assigned to another job, director of engineering and safety. When his ship Columbia exploded in 2003, killing 7 astronauts, he criticized NASA cost-cutting. And although he was a hero to the other astronauts, that was pretty much the end for him at NASA, and he was retired. So John Young was a hero, but to a certain extent, he was a victim of the growing NASA bureaucracy over the last 50 years. We're going to move on now to Jerry Van Dyke, who died recently at the age of 87. He was the younger brother of Dick Van Dyke. He was a talented guy, but not quite as talented as his brother. He wasn't quite as lucky, and he made a bad career decision. He appeared a couple of times on the Dick Van Dyke Show as Dick's brother, Stacy, who had narcolepsy. He bounced around a couple of other television shows. He was on the Judy Garland Show. Finally, in the mid-60s, he was offered the lead in a sitcom. And that sitcom was Gilligan's Island. He would play the Gilligan role. He turned it down because he said it was the stupidest thing he ever read. Now, I'm not going to defend Gilligan's Island to Shakespeare, of course, but it turned out it was a quite successful show, and it's still running in reruns everywhere. Meanwhile, Jerry Van Dyke opted to be the star in a different sitcom a year later, and it was this.
Well, you all may think my story is more fiction than it's fact, but believe it or not, my mother dear decided she'd come back as a car. She's my very own guiding star, a 1928 quarter. That's my mother dear. She helps me through everything I do, and I'm so glad she's here. My mother car.
My mother the car. Now, compared to My Mother the Car, Gilligan's Island is Hamlet. It sort of took the same theme as Mr. Ed, where only Jerry Van Dyke could hear his car talk, and it was Ann Southern's voice. Let's just say the concept didn't work again. Not only was the show canceled after one season, it's generally regarded as one of the worst shows ever made. It took Jerry Van Dyke a long time to recoup his career, but he finally did in the late 80s, early 90s on a show called Coach with Craig T. Nelson, who's a good actor, and Shelley Fabre from long ago, The Donna Reed Show. Here's Jerry with Craig T. Nelson.
I think we're just going to have to cut him from the phenol. I mean, I know his heart is in the right place. You can never find it, but I'm sure maybe we can get him some of that hipposuction everybody's been talking about. I mean, I can certainly sympathize with him. I've had a weight problem my entire life. Of course, I always like to eat fat and stuff. Heaven knows I'm overweight, but I mean, this kid is overweight. I never in my life.
Luther. Morning.
You think I'll just be negative, don't you?
No, we need Fred to play on Saturday. You're going to have to ride him.
And if he gets any bigger, I'll be able to.
Let's close on Jerry with the two brothers singing a little bit late in life.
We're two of a kind, that's right, two of a kind. It's my observation, we're two of a kind. Like peas in a pod, or birds of a feather, alone or together you'll find that we are two of a kind. One more time, that we are two.
Well, I'm going to close on that note. I want to thank my producer and IT genius, Sid Tepps. We're going to close tonight with Rick Hall, who died recently at the age of 85, a major figure in post-war American music. He was the music producer and main creator of the Muscle Shoals sound from his famed studio in Muscle Shoals, Alabama. And this was a major bridge between black and white music, rock, soul, and country. in the late 60s and early 70s. Here's Matthew Bannister from the BBC 4 Last Word on Rick Hall.
The town of Muscle Shoals, Alabama, is forever associated with soul music. And the man behind that soul success was the producer, Rick Hall.
There is a Muscle Shoals sound. It's heavy on the bass, heavy on the kick drum, and it's got a lot of balls.
The Radio 2 presenter, Bob Harris, is on the line now. But what sort of a background did Rick Hall come from?
A very poverty-stricken background. He was part of a Mississippi family of sharecroppers, and they had very little money. And there was some tragedy also in his early life. His father was very into gospel music, and I think gospel and country were his early influences. But as his career grew, he became, and you can say this looking back at him now, but he was a junction point in America for rhythm and blues, gospel and country music, and is one of the most important sort of founding fathers of the American music we know today.
How did he set up his first studio?
He was a writer initially. It was, in fact, a publishing company in the way that he got going, called the Florence, Alabama Music Enterprises. And he was a songwriter. He worked with Billy Sherrill, among others. Roy Orbison was one of the very early people to cut one of his songs, Sweet and Innocent, it was called, in 1959, and he set up the office, and then from that extended into a studio. And as that became more successful, he got bigger premises, and that's where fame in the early 1960s was really established.
And why did that studio become such a magnet for music talent?
It is an incredible thing, this, because when you think, it was rather out of the way part of Alabama, and yet this location then became one of the most important touch points for American music through, well, the next 15, 20 years at least. You Better Move On was the first really big, big hit to come out of fame, covered then by the Rolling Stones. And you've got then this connection between soul music and rock. Duane Allman was one of the people who was a young lad hanging out around the Fame studios. And then ultimately Jerry Wexler from Atlantic Records began to bring some of their artists down from New York, Aretha Franklin, Wilson Pickett, Arthur Connolly recorded there. And so you've got this really quite extraordinary junction point in the southern states. And just one other point about this too, Sam Phillips was a big mentor figure for Rick Hall, and the two of them were both white guys who loved black music, who fused black music and white music in the way that Sam Phillips did with Elvis Presley.
I gather there was a bit of a row in 1969 when some members of his rhythm section split off and formed their own studio. Why did that happen?
It was an argument between Rick Hall and Jerry Wexler. I think it involved a drummer in the band, and Rick Hall went round to see him. A fight ensued, and then Jerry Wexler said that he was never going to talk to Rick Hall again. So he went off and funded what became a kind of rival studio.
And lots of people came to record at that studio too, I gather. But why was Rick such an important figure in the history of popular music?
Passion, I would say. He absolutely believed in this music. I mean, he'd started in country, talking about the soul hits of the mid-1960s, but he returned to country later on, and also had big pop hits too with the Osmonds and others, Bobbie Gentry. And so he made his mark across the genres, and that junction point idea, I think, is a really important one.
Well, you heard Bob Harris mention Bobbie Gentry there, and I'm going to close with a Bobbie Gentry song. No, not Ode to Billy Joe, one of her later songs that I think is an even better song. Some of you younger listeners may know it by Reba McEntire, but this is the original, written and performed at Rick Hall's Fame Studios by Bobbie Gentry in 1970. This is Fancy.
It sounded like somebody else that was talking, asking Mama, what do I do? And just be nice to the gentleman, Fancy, and they'll be nice to you. Here's your one chance, Fancy, don't let me down. Here's your one chance, Fancy, don't let me down. September.